So friends, welcome in this very important interactive session on the atomic physics. So to begin with, let me put in front of you the syllabus from TYBSC Physics and MSc Part 1st Physics. So on the right hand side, you can see the syllabus from the TYBSC, where the whole syllabus of atomic spectroscopy was concerned with the doublet spectra. So it is the observed hydrogen fine structure, then the single valence electron spectroscopy, that is doublet spectra, spectrum of sodium, selection rule, intensity rule, normal Zeeman effect, then anomalous Zeeman effect, and etc. etc. And second was the molecular spectra. So these are the things which you have already learned and you have already studied, even though in my lecture, you will see that I will be covering most of the part which you have already studied. The very reason for this is, once you understand what you have already learned and once the doubts from the previous syllabus are already cleared, then it would be very easy for you to learn what is given in the unit 1 number 1 and unit number 2 of MSc Part 1 Atomic Spectroscopy, where Unit 1 and 2 concerns with atomic spectroscopy and 3 and 4 concerns with the molecular spectroscopy. I will not touch to these two points because these are already been started here on the university campus. But these two units I feel I will explain, and I to be honest, I will tell you, I have not prepared for this lecture. Even though you will see the all the concepts, whatever I have understood, I try my level best to convey to the students, wherein I will be talking about the two valence electron spectroscopy. What is the two valence and what is the doublet spectra, what is singlet spectra, what is triplet spectra, I am going to clear. And there, LLSS, LS coupling, then the interaction energy for the LS coupling, Land interval rule, branching rule, Hund's rule, selection rule, intensity rule, all these I will be covering. And very important, three important effect: when we apply weak or strong magnetic field, what happens to the spectra, and when we apply weak and strong electric field, what happens to the spectra. So these are the effects called as Zeeman effect, Paschenbach effect, and Stark effect. So here we are going to see these effects for two valence electron atom. So let me make one important thing clear, that my discussion would be more oriented about explaining more detailed aspects about the two valence electron spectroscopy. And in TYBSC, you already studied about the single valence electron spectroscopy. So let us start. So the first word, spectrum, is a very important word in the atomic spectroscopy or in the study of physics. So spectrum is spreading, range, or the spread. In our aspect or in our context, the spectrum is a spreading of wavelength or spreading of frequency. So we will be talking about the range of frequencies or range of wavelength, its spreading and its absorption and its emission due to presence of a matter. The way in which electromagnetic radiation interact with the solid and what happens to the electromagnetic radiation after absorption or after emission. So if you analyze that, and the graph what you get, the picture what you see is called as the spectrum. In 1967, as you know, for the first time, Sir Isaac Newton, he showed when white light, polychromatic light, when it falls on a prism, it gets splitted into its components, its colors, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. We call this as the dispersion. We call it as a spreading. So why this is so, and what way this is related to our topic of discussion? Because I would like to explain you the fact that when we see a color of a material, then that color, either it is absent or either it is a present. Whether that color is absorbed or whether that color is emitted matters in the spectrum. So, in a ordinary spectroscope, which is a prism spectroscope, we have monochromator like we have etalon, we have papyrus etalon, for example, or we have grating element for the prism. But a general spectrometer consists of source of light, then slit for avoiding the unwanted radiation to fall on the spectrometer, then the lens for focusing, and then a lens for collecting the diffracted radiation, and again slit and the eyepiece. So we have such kind of optical arrangement in the simple prism spectroscope. Now, so what we see when a material is kept here, for example, in the path of the electromagnetic radiation, and when the light coming from it is analyzed by the telescope, what you can see? There are various possibilities what we can see. We can see there is a color which are continuously separated, and these are the colors in the visible. So we see the band spectra. So this is called as band spectra because it contains the bands of the color. You can see some lines also, and these lines would be color or the black. If on the color background we see black lines, then these wavelengths are absorbed. Therefore, it is called as absorption spectrum. And on the dark background, few colored lines are seen, then it is called as emission spectrum. Generally, atomic spectra is a line spectra, and molecular spectra is the band spectra. In general, I am talking in general. So, after seeing the types of emission and absorption spectrum, let me proceed further to show you few spectrum. So these are atomic spectrum of sodium, hydrogen, calcium, mercury, which are in the visible. 4,000 angstrom to 7,000 angstrom is the range of electromagnetic radiation called as visible light, as you can see here, whose frequency is of the order of 10 to the power of 14 to 10 to the power of 15 hertz. And then on the right hand side, ultraviolet, X-rays, gamma rays, and on the left hand side, infrared, etc., etc. So this, we will be talking of interaction of these electromagnetic radiation, visible radiation, with atoms, and most commonly in the ground state, and exactly same is studied in the In the atomic spectroscopy, interaction of electromagnetic radiation with the atoms, most commonly in the ground state, are studied. And the very reason why we call this light as electromagnetic radiation, because the energy content is being carried out, is being transferred from one point to another in a straight line in the form of electric and magnetic field dancing mutually perpendicular to each other. So, electric field component going up and down and magnetic field component going side by side, which are mutually perpendicular to each other, and therefore this light, which has got wave nature, in fact the photons are not got have wave nature, the energy which is being carried in the form of electric and magnetic field, it has wave nature, and therefore it is called as electromagnetic radiation. When electromagnetic radiation it is being absorbed, or after absorption it is being re-emitted, then we get a spectrum. Maybe we get a band spectrum, or we get a line spectrum, we get absorption spectrum or emission spectrum. Based upon these spectrum, the scientist since 1900, since last 125 years or so, they are speculating various models in their mind. How the atom would have been formed, how the molecules would be, and based upon the spectrum and the interpretation, their perception in 1903, Thomson, he demonstrated that the atom contains positive and negative charge, which are uniformly distributed in the spherical atom. But there were some disadvantages which were removed by Rutherford by his Rutherford scattering experiment, and he showed that there is a concept of nucleus and there is a concept of electrons which are moving in the outermost shell in 1904. In 1911, Bohr put forth this very important, very historic model, where three Bohr's postulates we know about: the circular orbit, about the elliptical orbit, about the emission, about the absorption. All this Bohr model came. Then the concept of elliptical orbit was put forth by Sommerfeld, and in 1913, Sommerfeld relativistic model came into picture, wherein the first orbit is the circular orbit and the remaining orbits are the elliptical orbit. This was the concept. But later on, after advent of quantum mechanics, the concept of shell structure is called as the classical picture of the atom. So quantum mechanical picture, where instead of the various orbits of the electron around the nucleus, we talk of probability of finding electron around the nucleus at certain distance, at certain instant of time. So this is also called as a wave mechanical model, which was developed by Schrödinger in 1926. So we are going to discuss the middle model between these two, Sommerfeld model and wave mechanical model, called as a vector atom model. We suppose the situation that there is a nucleus, proton and neutrons are there, negative to positive charge is there, and there are electrons which are revolving around the nucleus in the orbits. For sake of understanding, you see, if you don't consider the orbit shell model, then whatever we study in atomic spectroscopy cannot be explained. So we should assume wave mechanical model in the limiting classical case, right? So I will be talking of the very important concept of the orbit of electrons around the nucleus or the electron has orbital motion around the nucleus and it has a spinning motion around the nucleus. If we suppose each motion is represented by a vector for the representative motion, and this vector is precessing, as I said, vector is precessing. And why the precessing? Because electrons are orbiting around the nucleus and they are spinning. So this frequency of orbiting and spinning should be represented by, and this is called as classical precession, and the precession of frequency is called as Larmor frequency, and I will be talking of the vector model in detail in this my lecture. So let us begin with the very important concept of a hydrogen problem. Is the simplest problem. We have a nucleus and there is only one electron which is orbiting around this nucleus. Now, if this is a three-dimensional motion or the spherical motion around the nucleus, then the motion of this electron which is orbiting around the nucleus can be represented by spherical polar coordinate system r theta phi. You know the relation between r theta phi, and you know forward relation, you know inverse relation, and e psi is equal to h psi. The Schrödinger equation can be applied to this problem, and you have learned this problem at extent by expressing Hamiltonian in terms of the del operator, where it is a function of r theta and phi. It is being applied on psi to get energy eigenvalue z, and this problem can be solved by method of separation of variable, where the position or radial part is written, another angular part is written, and third angular part is written. So we have two angles. This is azimuthal angle and other is the polar angle, and therefore the radial, polar and azimuthal parts, psi can be considered as the product of three functions, r the function of r, p the function of theta, and f the function of phi. So r the function of r gives the solution if and only if in the expression for r n appears whose value should be 1, 2, 3, not 0, 1, not 1.5. So therefore These are the whole numbers, principal number. Therefore, this number is called as principal quantum number. And again, this P theta gives the solution if and only if the L which appears in theta, it has the value 0, 1, 2, 3 up to n minus 1. And this Fi gives solution if and only if ML takes all possible values between minus L2 plus L. So, solution of a hydrogen problem or Schrödinger equation is the origin for the quantum numbers, very important principal quantum number, azimuthal quantum number, and magnetic quantum number. Keep in mind here the origin of spin quantum number was not considered. But of course, we will take into account the origin of spin quantum number also soon. So, based upon these quantum numbers, we know the atom and the electrons and their say this orbits can be divided into cells and subcells. We know K, L, M, N are the names of the cells depending on principal quantum number N. And sharp principal diffuse fundamental, SPDF, where azimuthal or orbital quantum number has the values 0, 1, 2, and 3. So here it should have been 3, right? So accordingly, orbits are designated as 1 as 2 as 2p, 3 as 3p, 3d, etc. etc. Of course, all these are primary things, and in high school and in junior college, you have learned this. But what I suppose is the thing which I have represented. If you calculate the energy of these subcells or the electrons in these subcells, you will see that the situation is 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 4s, 3d, 4p, 5s, 5d, 5p, 6s, 4s. It is not according to principal quantum number. Not all levels of one quantum numbers are synchronously placed as here, like this. You can see here, all these are depend upon the energy and the solution which we are going to discuss just touch. So this hydrogen spectrum, well-known hydrogen spectrum, the calculated energy of the nth electron or the energy of the electron in the nth orbit, En, is given by mz square e square upon 8 epsilon square h square n square, where n is the principal quantum number. So, according to Bohr's postulate, delta E or h nu is equal to hc by lambda, which is equal to 2 minus E1. If I put this n1 and n2 there and I simplify, I get 1 upon lambda is equal to rh 1 upon n1 square minus 1 upon n2 square. This RH is called as a Rydberg constant, and its value is a constant for given solid. Keep in mind, this is a constant. It is not constant same for all. And we see, I'm sorry, but this is very, very small graph. But you see, with respect to atomic number, Rydberg constant, it changes. And it tends to our infinity. And its variation is very high when Z changes from 1 to 20. So, Rydberg constant, though it is a constant, it is constant for material, but not constant for all. So, based upon this, from where the electron jumps, from higher energy level to lower or lower to higher, if it is lower to higher, absorption, if it is higher to lower, it is emission. So, when the electrons from n is equal to 2, 3, 4, 5 falls to n is equal to 1, then it is called as a Lyman series. This is the first series, Lyman series, this one. Then N2, NF2, NI3, 4, 5, 6, it is Balmer, Paschen, we have Paschen, then Brackett and Poole. So if you see the positions of the Lyman, Balmer, Paschen, Brackett, Poole on the electromagnetic spectrum, you see that Lyman series lie in visible UV below 200 nanometer. Balmer series lie in visible. This is the visible range. And the Paschen, Brackett and Poole, they lie deep in air. And every series has got the limits. The reason for this is because this limit is on the lower side, lower wavelength side, means higher energy side, because as you go above and above and above, the distance between energy level decreases, decreases, and there is a continuum, we call it as a merging, and therefore there is a limit. And we know the hydrogen atom radial wave functions and their normalized spherical harmonics for theta and phi, they are given by, and they can be plotted conveniently to show how the electron probability distribution in case of hydrogen can be shown by a wave function or the probability function of 1s, 2s, 3s, 4s, 2p, 3p, 4p, 3d, 4f, all wave functions are plotted. These are probability, not exactly a wave function. It is a normalized probability, psi square dv, psi square 4r square dr in case of a three dimension. As you can see here, 1s, 2s, 3s. And this wave mechanical model is true in case of a hydrogen, as you can see. But keep in mind, this wave mechanical model is a true three-dimensional probability distribution function, though we can see as a probability distribution. But whatever result of spectroscopy tells us that our classical perception about the atom and its states also is correct. So, let us begin our discussion about the vector atom model. We know electron has got orbital motion around the nucleus and it has got spinning motion. So, if I represent the orbital angular momentum, which is the principal quantum, which is the orbital angular momentum, which is related to the azimuthal quantum number, it can be represented as a precessing vector, a vector which has got magnitude, and it can be represented as L star is equal to square root of L into bracket L plus 1, where L is the azimuthal quantum number or orbital quantum number. Then if it is so, and if the charge is rotating, then it produces its own magnetic moment. And this magnetic moment, if it is moving, then if it is interacting, then it gives rise to quantization. What after all quantization is? So, this precession of angular momentum is defined by characteristic frequency called as a Larmor frequency. And this Larmor frequency is given by EL upon 2ME. ME is the effective mass, L is the length of the angular momentum vector, which is equal to square root of L into bracket L plus 1. Here you can see. So, and its modulus is equal to L star H, according to Bohr's postulate. Now, somebody will say, sir, whether this vector which is precessing in this space, of course there is a spinning motion also, it gives rise to the resultant vector. And if I represent this precession around the z axis, then whether this vector creates only one angle in which it can precess, the answer is no. Or whether it can take all possible values for the precession, the answer is no. Then it takes only few allowed values, or the angle between z axis and L bar is decided, and that angle is showed by here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 angles. So the angle made by the precessing vector around z axis is defined by a rule called as the quantization rule. And therefore, out of all possible, only few are allowed. This is called as quantization. And therefore, out of all possible angles that the L bar can take around Z, only these angles are allowed. Therefore, it is called as quantization. So, projection of L star along a direction in space is quantized to value 1 unit of angular momentum apart. And the diagram shows that the possible values of magnitude quantum number ML, and which is responsible for defining a new quantum number, which is called as a magnetic quantum number, which is a projection of L star on z axis. So ML takes all possible values between ML to L to minus L at unity interval, L minus 1, etc. Later on, it was observed that this 3p to 3s transition in case of sodium should have been only one. In fact, it is not a single transition. It was observed that at high resolution, this difference is 0.6 nanometer. 0.6 nanometer is very small, but that too was identified by the scientist. And they were thinking that, what is the cause for this? So Schrödinger picture was not able to explain the origin of this doublet in the sodium spectrum. And this possible orange line of sodium, 3p transition to 3s transition, that is from 2p 3 by 2 to 2p half, 2p 3 by 2 to 2s half, and 2p half, 2ts half. This doublet, very close to this basic level, was proposed due to the additional motion of the electron, and that is the spinning motion of the electron. And this spinning motion of the electron, when gets coupled with the orbital motion of the electron, gives rise to actual state of the electron in the atom. And therefore, the three scientists, Goldsmith, Alan Beck, and the students, graduate students of the Netherlands, Samuel Goldsmith and George Alan Beck, proposed the spin motion. So we have either clockwise and anti-clockwise spinning motion, though for only two quantizations, and very similar to L bar. Here is the projection of vector S on the Z axis, and which gives rise to Sz, or spin magnetic quantum number. Okay. So now for each motion, I have one vector, S star, L star, and they have got their own values, quantizations. So when both motions are coupled, while spinning it is rotating, therefore this is called as coupled motion. Very similar to motion of Earth around the Sun. It is spinning around its axis. It is spinning around the axis passing through it, and simultaneously it is spinning around the Sun, orbiting around the Sun. So this is synchronous motion. So this is motion is called as coupled motion. Very similarly, this precessional motion of the spin vector and orbital motion gives rise to the third vector, because this is vector. This gives rise to the third vector called as total angular momentum vector, which is called as J bar, and its value is L bar plus S bar. Now this J bar, now we know any charged particle, when it is in motion, it produces its own magnetic field. So when we project J bar on Z axis, then it has got its own values, M, J, H bar. So here, to calculate the angle between the precessic vector, the famous law of cosines is applied. We know if this is angle A, B and C, and this is length A, this is B and C, then these are the relations. A square is equal to B square plus C square minus 2A, 2BC cos A, and etc. Similarly, if this is L star and this is S star, and if I put this L star there, then this becomes a triangle. And we want the angle between L star and it would be J star square plus L star square plus S star square minus 2 L star S star cosine of the angle between L star and S star, where L star is given, S star is given. So let me show you how this can be formed. Yeah, this is the triangle. Vector resultant J bar is given by the cosine law. And it is very customary to find out for a given term value, if you know the term value, for example, 2p 3 by 2 or 2p half, you know all quantum numbers. It is doublet, therefore S is equal to half. It is p, therefore L is equal to 1. And it is half, so J is equal to half. Therefore, you know L, S and J. Just put these here, L, S and J. Get S star, S star, J star. Put there and find out the angle between S. And you will know, for a given configuration, if you have three term values, then there are three angles. That's what it means. Hope you have understood what I am explaining. Whether it is going well, Saurabh?
Yes, sir.
Lad?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there is a precession of L and S to give J, to get the required fine structure. Why it is called as a fine structure? Because later on the word hyperfine structure also will come. So according to Bohr model, there is a transition of electron from 2p orbit to 1s orbit, giving rise only one line. But if you magnify this line, you will see, though it appears on larger magnification a single line, it is not a single line. It is a doublet. And therefore, when we magnify and see it, it is the fine structure that we are looking at. And therefore, the name fine structure. And why it is so? This fine structure is due to spinning motion of the electron. Now, this is what you have learned in PYBSC. You have studied single valence electron spectra, also called as alkali spectra, also called as doublet spectra. Let me clear your doubt. What would be the doublet spectra? So before that, various spectra are called as singlet spectra, doublet spectra, triplet, quartet, quintet, sextet, septet, and then we have octet, etc., etc. So why we are getting these two lines? Because my initial level has doublet structure. I have two lines. Therefore, if this final line is one, therefore I am getting two lines. Therefore, this is called as a doublet. If I have initial one line and final also one line, I will get singlet. If I have initial three lines and final one line, I will get triplet. So depending on the initial level configuration or structure, it is called as singlet, doublet, triplet, quartet, etc. So what you have learned in TYBSC was a doublet spectra, because there was only one electron in the valence shell, as in case of lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium. You can see 2s, 3s, 4s, 5s, 6s, or there is only one electron in the outermost orbit. And we know all these are highly reactive elements because they carry single electron in their outermost orbit. And that one electron, when the spinning motion and the orbital motion of this electron gets coupled, would give rise to J. Now, if you mix the quantum numbers, you will say that the term value is a doublet. How come? I will tell you. So this simple thing you have learned, and based upon that, a lithium energy level diagram can be calculated. Because for lithium, you know the Rydberg constant of the lithium, and you know the formula for the energy of the electron in the nth orbit for the lithium. You can find out the energy in electron volt for lithium for 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, etc., etc. Lithium. We have how many electrons in the lithium? Sir?
Sir, 4.
Here?
3.
There, 3, Saurabh. It is not 4. 3, 3.
Oh, yes, sir.
So there are 2 electrons in 1s orbit, and there is only 1 electron in 2s orbit. Therefore, the ground state of the electron is the neutral state, which is 2s. Therefore, 1s is not shown. Keep in mind, for lithium, atomic number is 3. Therefore, ground state is 2s. And all other possible energy states can be drawn for the lithium. Somebody will say, sir, there are 3 electrons in the lithium. And what the electron is doing in other higher energy states? Yeah, the question is very right, because the 2s, 1s electrons are called as core shell electrons. They don't take part in any kind of interaction. They are like what you can say, they are hidden in a shell. But 2s electron can remain in 2s state or 2p state, 3s, 3p, 4s, 4p, etc., etc. And when it comes back to 2s or 2p, etc., etc., then the spectra is formed. Spectrum is formed, which is called as the ordinary spectrum. It is not a fine structure. And if you want to study the fine structure, you have to go for the doublet 3 by 2, doublet half. This 3 is the principal quantum number. It is not the 2. Okay. So all these things you have studied. You have studied for this normal G-Mann effect, anomalous G-Mann effect for this. But in MSc part 1, we are concerned with this second group element, beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, rhodium, where in their outermost orbit, there are two valence electrons in SL, 2S. If you see electronic configuration of beryllium, magnesium, calcium, zinc, strontium, cadmium, barium, mercury, you will find that there are two electrons in the outermost orbit. But as I said, these two electrons, they can be in the neutral state, in the ground state. But there is a possible that these two electrons, they can be in the higher energy states. So by taking into account all permutations and combinations, we can find out, we can develop energy level diagram for beryllium, magnesium, calcium, very similar to energy level diagram for the lithium. Okay. So this we are going to see two valence electron at spectroscopy. And it is called as a singlet and triplet spectra. It's used to singlet and triplet spectra. Now I have explained you what is singlet, what is triplet, what is quartet, etc. Before proceeding further, let me explain the concept of core electrons, valence electrons, equivalent electrons, non-equivalent electrons, and the configurations. A simple example of a magnesium where the atomic number is 12 is given. So I have shown the configuration as 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2. So the electrons of the 2p orbit, they are said to be in the core shell. Though they are there, they are like increasing the dimensions or volume of the atom. Of course, they have their own significance, but so far as interaction of electromagnetic radiation, external field, the atom is concerned, they have nothing to do. And therefore, we will dump them inside a core, and therefore they are called as core shell. Then which electrons are very important? The electrons in the outermost orbit. Therefore, in the ground state of the magnesium, both electrons in the 3s orbit. Somebody will say, sir, according to Pauli's exclusion principle, we don't have the two electrons. They can't be in the same state because their core quantum number, they can't be same. I will come to that also. But though they are here, their principal quantum number is same, their spin quantum number is same, but their magnetic quantum number needs to be different. Then only they will be in the ground state. Both will be in the ground state. So this is called as, these are called as equivalent electrons because their principal, both principal quantum number and their spin quantum number are same. These are called as equivalent electrons. And for example, one electron is in 3p orbit and another is in 4p orbit. Their L is same, pp, but the N is different. Therefore, they are called as non-equivalent electrons. Also, these are called as all valence electrons. Whatever they are above core shell, they are called as valence electron. And therefore, this is called as S-S configuration, dot is not there. And this is called as PP configuration. Here, dot I have put because they are non-equivalent electrons. Non-equivalent means their principal quantum number is different. And this is called as one electron in S orbit, other in P orbit. It is called as SP configuration. This is called as S-S configuration. This is called as PP configuration. For example, this electron, if it would have been here, it would have been PP configuration, equivalent electrons. Hope you have understood the concept of equivalent electron, non-equivalent electrons, core shell electrons. Shall I proceed further?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, very similar to coupling scheme for the single valence electron, because L bar and S bar can be represented for one electron. Now I have two electrons because I have S bar of one electron, L bar of one electron. It will give J bar, that is for one electron. I have S bar of second, L bar of second, and it will be J bar. So all vectors are precessing, and that picture can be imagined in the LS coupling. It is also called as Russell-Sounder coupling, in various possible ways. These are the two possible ways that the vector L1 and L2, they are coupled and gives rise to the capital L bar. S1 and S2 of two electrons, I am talking of the two valence electron atoms case, very simple case. when I have three valence electrons, it would be very difficult to imagine and compute. You have studied in TYBSE single valence electron atom system. Here it is a two valence electron atom. So when orbital momentum vectors are coupled together to give L bar and spin vectors are coupled together to give S bar, and effectively L and S, they are coupled together to give J bar. This is called as LS coupling. And this is the vector atom model for the two electron atom. Somebody will say, sir, why this L1, L2 is coupled? Whether L1 and S1 also can be coupled together? Yes, L1 and S1, spin motion of one electron is coupled with the orbital motion of the other electron to give J1 bar. Similarly, the spin motion of other electron is coupled to the orbital motion of the other electron to give J2 bar, and effectively it gives J bar. JJ coupling. It is called as JJ coupling. Can somebody think of another kind of coupling? Given four vectors, L1, S1, L2, S2, are there possible another coupling? Yes, there are L1, S2, L2, S1. But these interactions, the possibility of coupling L1, S2 and S2, L1 is very meager, very negligible. Therefore, these are not a dominant interaction. So dominant interaction in this is LL coupling, SS coupling to give JLS coupling. And here, LS coupling to give J1, LS coupling to give J2, and we have this. So magnetic interaction energy, or the interaction energy for this, because later on I'm going to define this, you will come to know gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, gamma 4, etc., etc. So gamma 1 and gamma 2 is dominant in LS coupling, and gamma 2 and gamma 3 is dominant in JJ coupling. Hope you have understood the concept of LS and JJ coupling. Now let us suppose that how the depending on the quantum numbers, how the angle between the two vectors is decided. Let us take example, one electron is in p orbit, where for p orbit, L is equal to 1. Keep in mind, yes, for S orbit, L is equal to 0, p 1, d 2, f 3, etc. So there is one electron in p orbit, where L1 is equal to 1, and there is another electron in p orbit, and L is equal to 1. So both vectors have got same magnitude, which is, what is the magnitude? Square root of 1 into 2, that is square root of 2. So L1 and L2 has got same magnitude. Even though the L has got three possible values. How come? We can use here cosine rule and put there the values of L1 and L2. And we see that depending on value of L1, L2 and L, the vector L bar, which is square root of L into bracket L plus 1, has got different value. For example, 0. L1, L2 is like above and L1 is below, like this. Same place. The angle is 0. If angle between them is 0, then L is equal to 0. If the angle between them is 60, then it is 1. So it is equilateral angle, therefore 1. And if this angle, this L1 and L2 is same, and this angle and this is root 6. This is root 6. 2 into 3, square root of 2 into 2 plus 1, that is 2 into 3, square root 6. So this is 0, square root 2 and square root 3. These are the lengths of L bar. And this is the case for LL coupling. And similarly, for PD configuration, this is for PP configuration, non-equivalent electrons. Now for PD configuration, this one is for PD configuration, this is for PA configuration. This is PD, just now I explained, PP configuration. Now PD, 1 and 2, 1 and 2. So L, how it is calculated? It L varies from L1 to L2 and L2 minus L1. L2 minus L1, 2 minus 1 is 1. 2 plus 1 is 3, So L values varies from 1 to 3 at unit interval, 1, 2, 3. So put values of L1, L2 and L in the formula for the cosine rule and get the angles, you will get these values. And similarly for PF, 1 and 3. So you get L star to be root 6, root 12, root 20. So this LL coupling, in LS coupling, is responsible to give the name to the energy levels. Energy level is also called as a term. It is also called as term value. Name of the energy level is SPD. L, L, L. L, S, P, D. P, D, F. D, F, G. And this is the, for rapid calculation, what you can do. You can just write down the configurations SS, SP, SD, SF, PS, PP, PD, PF, DS, DP, DD, DF, FS, FP, FD, FD. I mean by the fact that other than the core shell electrons, out of valence electron, one electron is in one orbit, that is first orbit, and second in the second orbit. If it is so, then what are the possible term values? So these are the term values and this is the term table. Keep in mind, I have put dot between S, P and D and F because these are non-equivalent electrons. Both are not in the same N value. Same N value. Hope you have understood this calculation. Similar is the case for SS configuration. So if I add half and half, because S is equal to half, S1 is equal to half, S2 is equal to half, these two electrons, if I add these two, then becomes 1, and if I subtract, then becomes 0. There are two possible values. So for two combinations, if I calculate cos theta according to cosine rule, one value comes out to be pi, because cos theta is minus pi, and in this cos theta is equal to 2 by 6, that is 1 by 3, and it is 70.53. So angle between S1 and S2, keep in mind, somebody will say, sir, there is a spin half and spin minus half. Clockwise and anti-clockwise. From where this angle 70 has come? So this is for two valence electron atom. Keep in mind. And we are talking of effective spin quantum number. And not the spin quantum number of individual electron. This is effective spin quantum number. So this S is equal to 0 gives rise to singlet. Later on you will come to know what do you mean by S is equal to 0 to be singlet and S is equal to 1 to be triplet. Because the multiplicity is given by 2S plus 1. And if I put S is equal to 0 there, it comes out to be 1. And if I put S is equal to 1, it comes out to be 3. So multiplicity comes out to be 1 and 3 in case of two valence electron atom. So angle is pi. Therefore, this one is this. This is angle 180. Therefore, they cancel out. 0 resultant. And here angle is 70. Therefore, resultant has got root 1 half and 3 by 2. So 3 by 6, root 3 by 6 is the value S bar. Fine. So what this is PP, LL coupling. This is SS coupling. Now we go for LS coupling. Where we don't think of these small quantum numbers L1, L2, which has given the PDF term for PD configuration. How to calculate the term values for the PD configuration? And when singlet is there, it's just mere addition. S is equal to 0, L is equal to 1, 2, 3. S is equal to 1, L is equal to 1, 2, 3. Here, the case of S is equal to 0 is taken. S is equal to 0, L1, L2, L3. So J is, of course, whatever L value it is, J is. Now I give the name to the term value based on these three quantum numbers. How? I can give the name to the value. It is 2s plus 1, then p and j. So this is the name of the term value. So name p. P means what is p value? Or p comes from l. So l is equal to 1. Therefore name p I have. Name P I have known. You see? And here it is J. Write superscript J, which is equal to 1. therefore 1 I have given. And multiplicity, 2s plus 1. What is s value? 0. So if I put 0 there, then it becomes 1. So 1p1. Similarly, 1d2. Similarly, 1f3. Right? Now, when it is equal to 1, what we have to do is take s is equal to 1, l is equal to 1. S is equal to 1, l is equal to 1. S is equal to 1, l is equal to 2. Three possible combinations. Now, here again, the j value changes from 1 minus 1, that is 0, 1 plus 1, that is 2. 1, 2, 0, 1, 2. 1, 2, 3. 2, 3, 4. Now, once again, I give the values as s is equal to 1, means 2s plus 1 is 3. Therefore, triplet. There are three components. 3p0, 3p1, 3p2. And how they have come? They have come from this. And how this 3d, 1, 2, 3 have come? Like this they have come. And how 3f2 by 3 has come? Like this it has come. So, it is very simple to understand. What you just know, need to know is a quantum number. Hope you have understood this. Have you understood this, Saurabh?
Hello, sir.
Have you understood this?
Yes, sir.
MSc part first. Nirmale, have you understood this? Lord?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I proceed further. So, this I was talking. Term symbol. Multiplicity is given by 2s plus 1. It is written as left superscript. J value, right superscript, subscript, and this is the L value, and above that number is written, it is not superscript, it is number, it is a N value. So generally, name of the energy level is given by the term symbol, say like this, 3, 2, S, half. Now, if you can see, these are the four term values, 1, 2, 3, 4. Here, N principal quantum number is 3, 3, 4, 4. Can write here 3, 3, 4, 4. L value, S means 0, P means 1, P means 1, D means 2. J value, straightly I can write this subscript, half, half, 0, 2. And S value, if it is singlet, it is doublet. Therefore, S value is half. And it is triplet, S is equal to 1. It is singlet, S is equal to 0. You see, 3, 2, half, half. 3, 1, half, half, 4, 1, 0, 1, and 4, 2, 2, 0. So, unless you understand this table, it is very, what you can say, it is not customary to proceed further, I personally feel. Means you should be able to find out the quantum numbers from the name of the term value, or you should be able to develop the name of the term value based upon the quantum numbers. So I want you or your signal, because I am midway of my lecture, because there are 60 odd or 70 odd slides, and this is 29th slide. Still one more hour I require. I require your patience, because this is very important discussion, and I know this is a collective information, and I have telling you atomic spectroscopy in a nutshell. So I want your signal. Shall I proceed further?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us think of a PD configuration. Once again, I revisit. For P electron, 1 and half are the quantum numbers, L1, S1. Other D electron, 2 and half are the quantum numbers. So, I think of LL coupling and then SS coupling. SS coupling will give me 0 and 1, and LL coupling will give me 0, 1, 2 and 3. LL coupling, 1, 2, 3, as I did. And SS coupling, 0 and 1. Right? Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
And LS coupling. So I need to have possible combinations. S is equal to 0, 3 combination. S is equal to 1, 3 combinations. That will give rise to S is equal to 0 will give rise to 1P1, 1D2, 1F3 term. Just now I explained. And L is equal to 1, S is equal to 1. And this give me 3P0, 3P1, 3P2, 3D1, 3D2, 3D3, 3F2, 3. What all are these are? These are the fine structure component which has occurred due to position of one electron in P orbit and other in D orbit. So these are the energy levels. You see, so these are the only 9. 3 3s are 9 and these 12 energy levels which are resulted due to this configuration. If there are 2 electrons in single atom, then forget of core electrons. Only you need to concern these 12 energy levels. Somebody will say, sir, if I pour 1000 electrons or if I take the system of 1000 atoms simultaneously, what will happen to these energy levels? Of course, these energy levels are going to turn into bands. But the concept of bands we discuss based upon 1s, 2s, 2p orbits. Now you discuss in terms of 3p0, 3p1, 3p2 orbits. So, PD configuration, either we have singlet terms or triplet terms. And this has due to spin-spin interaction, SS coupling. Therefore, S is equal to 0 and S is equal to 1. S is equal to 0 singlet, S is equal to 1 triplet. Now, orbit-orbit. So, in singlet, I have 3 energy levels. And in triplets, I have 9 energy levels. So, in singlet, 1P, 1D, 1F. And in triplets, 3P, 3D, 3F. So, 3P means 3P has 3 components. And 3D has 3 components. And 3F has 3 components. So, effectively, the picture sees that spin-spin coupling is responsible in deciding whether your singlet or triplet spectra, whether it is doublet spectra or quartet spectra. Orbit-orbit is responsible for giving the names of the singlets and triplets, and spin-orbit interaction is responsible to give the interaction value by how much amount. You see, if this is the original term value, then by how much amount this energy level has shifted has to do with one interaction energy means shift, second interaction energy means shift, and third interaction energy. So these are the term values. You can develop the term table for SP configuration. There are 4 terms. For P dot P, keep in mind, for this P dot P, which is non-equivalent, keep in mind, because this will come when I explain the Pauli's exclusion principle. So for explaining Pauli's exclusion principle, you see, 1s, 1p, 1d, 3s, 3p, 3d. So how many? 3, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 terms are there in P dot P non-equivalent electron configuration. And just now we saw PD configuration, there are 12 terms. As I said, if you know the term values, you can find the angle. So this is the example 2D 5 by 2. It is doublet. This is from single valence electron spectroscopy. Somebody say, sir, it is doublet because it is singlet and triplet spectra that you are discussing, and from where? Just for sake of understanding, I have given this example. 2D 5 by 2. These are the examples which are asked in net and set examination. Find the angle between L and S for 2D 5 by 2. Nothing given. So 2D 5 by 2, we have to unfold the quantum numbers. Half 2 5 by 2. Put in the formula for the cosine rule and get the angle to be 61. And you can see it is around 62. For example, this is PD configuration, FP configuration, one electron in 3 orbit, L is equal to 3. Then it is FP configuration, the term values are asked. And you need to find out the term values. So very simple. You can find out all the term values just by knowledge of quantum numbers. So you must have understood now the importance of quantum numbers. Until now, just I am talking of maths and I am playing with the numbers. And just you give me the name and I have quantum number and I put it in my calculation, I give you something. So, somebody will say whether only LS coupling is possible. No, JJ coupling also is possible. L1 S1, L2 S2. For that one, what you need to do is combination of quantum numbers. Here LL I do. Do the LS. LS will give J1, J2. This will and again form J1, J2 will give J. So 12 terms. Here also 12 terms. Number of terms will be same for the same configuration from LS and JJ coupling. And this is asked in the problem. Assuming JJ coupling, find possible J values. Assuming LS coupling, find possible L and J. So this is the answer. And this is very important. Pauli's exclusion principle. We know this Pauli's exclusion principle statement everybody knows. No two electron in an atom can have all their four quantum numbers set. Which are these four quantum numbers? N, L, ML and MS. What this ML and MS? These are magnetic orbital and magnetic spin quantum numbers. And what is the origin of these magnetic quantum numbers? When L, it rotates around Z axis, the projection of L on Z axis gives rise to intercept called as a quantum number, new quantum number, and that is a magnetic quantum number. And the value of magnetic quantum number varies from L to minus L. Say S to minus S. So, in PP configuration or P square configuration, we have the quantum numbers L1 1 and L1 1, L2 1, S1 half and S2 half. So, with the usual method, we can find the term values. What we will do? We will add L1 L2, subtract L1 L2. We would add S1 S2, subtract S1 S2, get capital S, get capital L. Combine S and L in all possible ways, get J, and based upon S, L and J, capital, get the term values. But in this case, we forget that if these are equivalent electrons, we need to consider, keep in mind this fact. Their four quantum numbers should not be same. At least one quantum number should be different. So how this can be done? So already N and L is same. So we choose all combinations where ML and MS are different. So for this, L is same, L is same, S is same, S is same. So what I do, I write now the magnetic quantum numbers for or the possible combination of magnetic quantum numbers for one electron. So possible combination for the one electron, that would be one and this N and L for one electron and MS of course, S is of course, but MS will be half and minus half. But MS is equal to half and minus half and ML is equal to 101 because ML changes from L to minus L. In this case, L is 1. So 1 to minus 1. So these are 6 possible combinations. But half 1, half 0, half minus 1. Minus half 1, minus half 0, minus half minus 1. So these are all 6 possible combinations. Now what I do, I take this combination and this combination from second electron. Red is for second electron. So in my case, all the four quantum numbers would be same. And I will be violating the Pauli's exclusion principle. I will tell why it is called as exclusion principle. So I will violate these combinations. So what I do, NL are already same. So I ignore AA combination. AA combination. So what I take? I take AB combination. So A from here and B from there. So half 1, half 0, one quantum number is different. So it is working for me. AB, AC also you can see. AC, one quantum number is different. AD, minus half, this is different, though one is same. AE, AF, you can just look at this. BC, BD, BE, BF, CD, CE, CF, DE, DF, DEF. So all these are 16 combinations. So what I do, I add up all these quantum numbers. Why do I add? Because I want to know the name of the term value, which is there due to this rule. So what I do, I take A from there and B from there and add this number. Half and half, I add 1. 1 and 0, I add 1. So similarly, I do all calculations and I get 16. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. I'm sorry, 15 combinations. So these are effective MS and ML. If effective MS and ML are there, then I can get capital S and capital L out of this. How come? You see, I have highlighted by numbers by pink color. So 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2. And I have separately written them here. So MS is 0 and ML changes from 2 to minus 2. It means that capital L should be 2 and capital S should be 0. Now who will tell when capital L is equal to 2 and S is equal to 0, this will give rise to singlet D. Now I take out this 0, 0 and I write there. 0, 0 means MS is 0 means S is 0, L is 0, L's 0, L 0 means singlet S. And remaining black colored number, I write there. And now I see MS changes from 1, 0, minus 1, 1, 0, minus 1. So MS changes from 1 to minus 1, ML changes from 1 to minus 1 means S is 1, L is 1. That is triplet P. So these are three terms. This is one and this is one. So 3 into 5 terms are there. But P dot P configuration, if I just take you a little back and you remember yourself, P dot P configuration gave me 1, 2, 3, 4 and these 6. 10 terms. Out of these 10, 5 are allowed according to polyexclusion principle. And what about remaining? They are excluded. That is the reason why the name exclusion principle. So the two equivalent p electrons therefore give rise to singlet S 3p 1d terms. For the term table p dot p configuration, LX coupling, it is seen that two non-equivalent p dot p electrons give rise to 1s 1p 1d 3s 3p 3d terms. The polyexclusion term principle thus excludes 1s, 3s, 3p, and these two electrons have equal n values. And so, similarly, equivalent s electron gives 1s, equivalent p electron gives 3, and this term table can be calculated. It is easy for you. You can do it for double D2 configuration. Whatever exercise I did for p dot p, you can do it for d dot d. If you are able to do it, then only you have understood it by all means. I have shown you the splitting singlet, triplets, and then SPD, and then one do J value. By how much amount they split, and that is given by interaction energy. And we can find out that interaction energy simply if you know the quantum numbers. You see, everything is possible if you know quantum numbers. How? So interaction energy for SS, LL, and the LS coupling can be calculated based upon the quantum numbers, and it is defined by minus TLS because it is a shift from the center of gravity. The center of gravity means the term which classical energy level, term value of the classical, minus 13.6 for example, electron volt. Is it not? This is center of gravity, and shift is given by TLS cos LS. Of course, all these, this is the academic exercise which you can do in the book. It is given. I am not going in details of derivation of this, but it is given by this ALS cos of cosine of the angle between, and cosine of the angle between this is given by this formula, this by 2. We know where A is a constant. It is function of what? Quantum numbers. You can see alpha. It is Phi structure constant. We know Z atomic number, R Rydberg constant. So each and everything can be known. So some constant, you can find out constant from the known quantum numbers and known constants. And these quantum numbers are involved. How J star square means what? J into bracket J plus 1. L star square, L into bracket L plus 1. S star square, S into bracket S plus 1. Here it is. So for 4P, 4D configuration, PD configuration, these are the term values. 1P1, 1D2, 1F3, 3P2, 3P1, 3P0, 3D3, 3D2. 3d1, 3f4, 3f3, 3f2. And what is the value by which singlets are splitted from the hypothetical center of gravity? Use this formula. Because for this, S1 half, half, S2 half, S is equal to 0 for singlet. So put it there and get, put half, half. Which S1 square means S into bracket S plus 1. Means half into half plus 1, that is 3 by 2. Half, 3 by 2. Half, 3 by 2. And here, 0, 1. So this will be 0 and put A by 2. This value comes out to be minus 3 A1 by 2. A1 by 4. And for if I put S is equal to 1 there, I will get A1 by 4. Somebody will say, sir, why minus is shown above generally on the axis? Minus is shown below. And plus is shown above. Here, reverse. It is seen that value of A1 itself is negative. So, negative, it will become positive. So, here it will become positive, and here it will become negative. Similarly, the case for gamma 2 interaction. By how much? This is center of gravity, not the center of gravity. By how much amount 1P1, 1D1, and 1F2, 1F will shift from this center of gravity? This is given by A2 by 2 L. L we know, L1 we know, L2 we know for 3D configuration 1 and 2. And L, just put 3 values. So you get 3 interaction energies. Minus 3 by 2, minus A2, minus 2 A2. And these are same here also for singlet and triplet. Here also minus is shown above, therefore A2 also is negative. And final, so based upon capital L, capital S and capital L, which we get here, we put it in this formula and we see that they are separated by A minus A minus 2A. 2A minus A dash minus 3A dash. 3A dash minus A dash minus 4A dash. This is the distance from this. And this A1, A2 and A are the constant which I have showed in earlier slide. So this you can see. One electron in 4p orbit, other in 4d orbit. So this is pd configuration, and these are the term values, 12 term values, and how they are situated. And therefore, instead of single line in before fine structure or in the Bohr model, you get these many lines. But how many lines? That also is decided by some rule. It is called a selection rule. Can we find the intensity? Yes, we can find the intensity as well. That is decided by the intensity rules. Somebody will say, sir, why triplets are lower? As I said, the value of A1 is negative. Why higher angular momentum states are lower? F is shown there. D is shown above. P, you can see L, P, D, F. L is lower, L is higher, L lower, L higher. Similarly, 1, 2, 3, or here, 2, 3, 1, J values, J high, low, low. So, if you look at the energy level diagram for PD configuration and closely look at the position of the term values, what you can see, the triplet lie deepest than the corresponding singlet. This is the Hund's rule 1. And of these triplets and singlets, the term having higher L value lie deepest. This is second Hund's rule. And for a given triplet, the term having lower J value lie deepest. This is the Hund's rule number 3. Somebody will say from where this has come, whether this is intuition? No, it is based upon the observation. Barely based upon the observation. Observation and then theory. But Hund's has formulated this rule, and therefore these are called as Hund's rule, the term with maximum multiplicity, that is triplet lie deepest. And for given multiplicity, the term with the largest L value lie deepest. For the given triplet, the level having lowest J value lie deepest. For example, this I have already explained this. Selection rule means you have given the term values, and after all, we are discussing the spectroscopy. is it not? So this is spectroscopy. Means we need to see, take the spectra. It should be absorption spectra or it should be emission spectra. So sir, you said, sir, there is a quantization in the energy levels, but there is a quantization in the selection of the transitions, and that is given by selection rule. So delta S is equal to zero is the first selection rule. Delta S zero means what? Within triplet or within singlet, there is no transition. Let me show you what do you mean by this. Within triplet means what? Within these levels, there is no transition. Within these levels, there is no transition. Means from 3P2 to 3P1, no transition. 3P2 to 3D3, yes. No, this also is not possible. I'm going to show you in few cases it is allowed. But delta S is equal to 0 is not allowed. At delta S is equal to 0 is the allowed transition. I'm sorry. Delta S is equal to 0 is the allowed transition. Delta N is unrestricted. From which N level to which N level transition occurs is unrestricted. Delta L 0 means from P to P, that is delta L is 0. P to D, yes, 1. D to P, yes, minus 1. But S, P, D, F. F to S, not allowed. Because L, delta L comes out to be 2. Similarly, you can look at these term values and you can see this rule and you can see the selections. Or theoretically predetermine the transitions. Now I have shown the transitions. 3D2, 3P2. Whether this transition is allowed? Triplet, delta S is 0. Yes, it is allowed. 2 to 1, delta J, 1. It is allowed. Delta L, 1. It is allowed. But here, 3P2, half and 1 S half. Delta S is 1. It is not allowed. Here also, delta S is not allowed. Within triplet, it is allowed. Within triplet, it is allowed. So, you have some 10 lines in the absorption or emission spectra of a given element or the molecule or what you can say compound. Then which is the intense line and how intensity varies? Can we theoretically determine it? Yes, it is given by the intensity rule. So ratio of the intensity of the transitions from M to N to P to Q is given by the ratio of the Boltzmann factors. E to the power of E by KT is the Boltzmann factor. And Boltzmann factor T is the temperature and mu n is the frequency of that energy level. Means energy. This has something to do with energy of the energy level. That energy level. So this is Boltzmann factor divided by Boltzmann factor. Initial, you see M initial, P initial energy level. And this is second term is the Einstein before correction. This you can take from annexary, you can study more about that. And this is about the sum rule. Sum of the intensities. Sum of the intensities of all lines of multiple which starts from common initial level is proportional to the quantum weight to J plus 1 of the initial level. So this is one sum rule and this is another sum rule. So some you need to look into, because now I don't have time and I will not teach you how this sum rule can be applied to a given transition and how we can find the intensity. So one example of transition between 3P to 3D is given here. And by applying the sum rule, because if I consider this constant, if I consider the intensity is proportional to the sum rule, then these are the values, one for this. And of course, you can see the transitions which are not allowed according to selection rule, their intensity is not shown. So if I add this and add that, you get 1 7 to 5 to 3. So this is the most intense line. And if you look at this is the most intense, 5 to 3 to 1 7 to 5 to 3. So these are not normalized intensity, so you can normalize it, divide each factor, each intensity by 168. So it and multiplied by 100, so it is normalized 100. So what you can see, this observed intensity or calculated intensity by some rule and the calculated intensity by the Brugger and Dongleberg, Dorgelow, by their sum is same. You can see it's almost same. So these are the intensity rules. You can find out the intensity of the transitions. There is one rule of the intervals for a given triplet. For a given triplet, you can see this 3P or 3D or 3F. And you see the energy difference between these two. Energy of this, energy of this, energy of this. If you have three energies with you, for example, interaction energy I'm talking, this minus that will give you 2A. This minus that I will give A. This minus that I will get 3A dash. This minus this I will get 2A. This minus that I will get 4A. This minus that I will get 3A. So I see that for a given triplet, that is for given SL and L and G, the pi structure energy difference or the difference of energy between these two energy levels is proportional to higher of the J values. So 2A is proportional to 2, A is proportional to 1, 3A is proportional to 3, 2A is proportional to 2, 4A is proportional to 4, 3A is proportional to 3. So this I have shown by calculating the term value, and this can be calculated by this interaction energy. This is called as Lambda interval rule. You see, within 20 seconds I have finished the discussion of Lambda interval rule. And this is the observation. This is not very hard rule. I have told you Hund's rule. I have told you Lambda interval. So the Bohr structure is a gross structure, which can be observed either in ultraviolet or visible or infrared. And this gross structure is from 1 to 10 electron volt. And this is due to electron nuclear attraction, electron kinetic energy, or electron electron repulsion. And we know when spin and orbit motion of the electron is coupled in various ways, just now I explained all possible combinations, then pi structure occurs. So this pi structure is between 0.001 to 0.01 electron volt. You see, you need to magnify your spectrum to that. But there is a fine structure of a fine structure. There is a fine structure, though this is a single line in fine structure. It is not single. It is made up of many components. It is called as hyperfine structure. And the energy difference between the hyperfine line is 10 to the power of minus 6 electron volt. As it is possible to resolve 10 to the power of minus 6 electron volt. And this is due to interaction of electron with nucleus. So whatever now, until now I have explained it by supposing the fact that my nucleus is at rest. My nucleus is not spinning. I suppose nucleus is stationary and electron is, valence electron is spinning. Two valence electrons are spinning. But now if I add spinning motion of a nucleus as well, like this, electron is spinning and orbiting in addition to nucleus spin. I have not considered the vibrations that will add more complexity. Only spinning, nucleus also is spinning. Then that will add to a new quantum number. There will be coupling of nuclear spin quantum number to the electron mechanical moment J bar to Q F bar resultant of the atom. And the best example of hyperfine structure or the flag pattern, they say, is the bismuth, where we have six components for 5722 angstrom line. Let us see what is that. So I have bismuth which has got 3 plus valency, mean 3 electrons. So it may have doublet structure. I have explained singlet and triplet, doublet you have seen. But when there are 3 electrons, the problem becomes still difficult. But you see how I and F, where quantization occurs, we have various angles between I and J according to this, and these are the values of vectors. So I get various quantum numbers F. What I need to know is J. So J is pi by 2. Fine. If I get pi by 2, I need to know I. I is here 9. Now if I add these two, 9 by 2 plus pi by 2, so I get 14 by 2, that is 7, I wrote there. and difference 9 minus 5, it is 4 by 2 is 2. I wrote there. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 are the effective quantum numbers, F. Now I can find interaction energy because I have set F, J and I. F, J and I can find out interaction energy. Interaction energy, you can find out. You can see the interval rule is applied here also. 7 a dash, 6 a dash, 5 a dash, 4 a dash, 3 dash. And the name of the term value you can see. It is doublet d phi by 2. Doublet d phi by 2. But it has got 6 components. And how they are distinguished? By left subscript 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 6. Right? So this is about the hyperfine structure. Branching rule. Is it possible to develop the energy level diagram for a given element if we don't do any calculations for real and n? If we don't know whether it is single valence, whether it is double valence, triple valence, yes, it is possible. And it is possible with the help of branching rule. Of course, still 20 minutes to half an hour I would require, because still Zeeman effect and Paschenbach effect and Stark effect is remaining. After branching rule, it is there. Please be patient. As I promised, I will take 2 hours, means 2 hours. So branching rule is used for the construction of energy level diagrams. And I have given the simple example of germanium, neutral germanium, where the electronic configuration is 4s2, 4p2. So you see 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 3d10, 4s2. This is the neutral electronic configuration when both electrons are in the 4s orbit. So while developing the energy level diagram for this germanium, what we have to do? We have to remove both the electrons. They are not there. We suppose they are not there. So the atom is supposed to be doubly ionized. Singly ionized means one electron is removed. Doubly ionized means both electrons are. And this state of the atom is written in here. 4p doublet p, because we can add only one electron and it would be doublet p. It would be doublet p here. So it is written here. Neutral atom and it is ionized atom. Now what I do, I'm developing the energy level diagram and I'm framing rule for that. So what I can do, so I can add second electron. One electron is in 4p orbit, for example. And I can add one electron in 5s orbit. So it is ps configuration. And we know for ps configuration, 1s1p1d, 3s3p3d are the energy diagrams or the levels. Or what I can do, I can put one electron in 4p orbit is there and other in 5p. So this is pp configuration and pd configuration. 4p, 4d, we have no d. So if you closely look at these energy levels and if you just go on adding the electrons in various energy levels, what I see when I am in p and I am adding electron in s, the multiplicity raises and decreases by 1. Pa. 1 and 3, 1 and 3, 1 and 3. And what is another rule? For getting L values, I am at P, L value raises and decreases by 1. S to P, S to P. Here you are in P, and if you are adding the electron in D orbit, then D to P, D to F. Adding electron in P orbit, so P to S, P to D. Adding electron in S orbit, only P. So by adding the second electron, the multiplicity goes up to triplet and down to singlet. If the added electron in S orbit, that is L is equal to 0, L value is not changed. Adding electron, the L value goes up and down, 1 including all internal values in between. Adding D electron, we get the states give same result as that of adding 4p. So you can do this and you can follow this branching rule for getting the term values. Next is very important, Zeeman effect, which is the splitting of the spectral lines under the influence of the external magnetic field. You see, I have explained you fine structure. I have explained you hyperfine structure. Now, explaining Zeeman effect is by considering the defined structure, not by hyperfine structure, because it will be again a complicated topic. So consider it, I have a fine structure, and this fine structure line I have fine, five lines are there, and I apply external magnetic field to my system. Then these five lines, they are no, they remain no more five, but some 15 lines are there. Why there is a splitting of lines? What is the origin of extra lines? So it is due to interaction of J with external magnetic field. Magnetic field also can be considered as extra vector, and my J is now precessing around S, magnetic field. So L and S, of course, they are precessing. This is for single, true for single valence electron. It is true for double valence electron. I'm sorry. Depending on strength of your magnetic field, whether it is a weak or strong magnetic field, the lines get splitted. If it is weak, you get many components. If it is strong, you get triplet. Single line gets splitted into triplet when strong magnetic field is applied. And single line gets splitted into many components, more than three, when weak magnetic field. This is called as anomalous Zeeman effect, weak magnetic field, normal Zeeman effect, strong magnetic field. All you have learned, this you have learned in TYBSC. Just for sake of revision, I am doing this because I wish to take the example from two valence electron spectroscopy. So we have 2p to 2s in the classical transition, single classical transition is two transition in fine structure. We have seen 2p 3 by 2 to 2s half, 2p half to 2s half. This is for single valence electron atom, keep in mind. Single valence electron, not for two, only one electron. So unperturbed spin orbit interaction. Now when we apply external magnetic field, this line splits into four components, this line splits into two components, this line splits into two components, and these two transitions are now 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 transitions. Can I devise a selection rule for this? Yes, you can. Can I have intensity rule for this? Yes, I can. But application of magnetic field in this direction has created two possibilities of observing the pattern. How? One, along the direction of magnetic field, and second, along the mutually perpendicular direction of the magnetic field. So depending on in which direction you are observing the Zeeman pattern, there is called as pi components or p components and sigma component and s component. So as I told, my J is now precessing around B. Therefore, magnetic quantum number plays into picture. Now I will not go into details of derivation of Landé splitting factor and the Bohr magneton and the interaction energy of the magnetic interaction. So the interaction energy of the magnetic field is a function of Landé splitting factor G, which is a function of quantum numbers. For given term value, you know J, S, L and J. S, L, J. Find G. Put there. Mu 0, EH upon 4 pi MC is a Bohr magneton. It's the unit for measuring the energy. We know Bohr, energy can be measured in terms of Bohr magneton. So it is a constant. H, applied magnetic field, and MJ, magnetic quantum number. If I suppose this Bohr magneton to be 1, then effectively magnetic interaction energy, the amount by which energy levels are splitted due to application of magnetic field, is called as magnetic interaction energy. Is MGL. MGL. L is MGL is the magnetic interaction energy. So effectively, the complete term value to any magnetic level may be written as T0, which is center of gravity, hypothetical center of gravity in the fine structure. Tau or gamma is the fine structure shift that we can know. That we can know from A, interaction energy for gamma 1, gamma 2, spin-spin, orbit-orbit or spin-orbit interaction, and MGL, nu. So, to study Zeeman effect, you need to know Z and M. That is important. L is a constant because applied magnetic field, whether it is strong or weak, that is a later question. So, you need to know Z and M. Can you calculate Z and M for a given transition? Yes, this is example for two valence electron spectroscopy, 2p3/2. So for 2p3/2, it is S is equal to half. P, therefore, L is equal to 1. This is 3 by 2. J is 3 by 2. And therefore, G can be calculated from the formula for the interaction. And it is 4 by 3. Now, this J is precessing around H. Then intercept. Projection of J star on H gives the magnetic quantum number. But projection of G star J, G J star on H will give rise MG. And this is very important. So M we know. Magnetic quantum number, they are 3 by 2, half minus half and minus 3 by 2. Because J is 3 by 2. So magnetic quantum number varies from J to minus J, 3 by 2, half minus half minus 3 by 2. And this is just projection. And you calculate MG. You see, 4 by 3 is Z and M is 3 by 2. So this, and if you take the difference between MG, it would be the energy difference between these two. This is not like Landé interval rule. And that is the reason why these human lines are equally spaced. The reason for this is the energy difference between in a given line is same. This, 4 by 3, 4 by 3. This is the schematic orientation diagram for the 2p 3 by 2 state. For single valence electron atom, keep in mind, in TYBSE you have learned this. And I want to find 2p to 2s transitions. So it would be, actually there will be two transitions in phi structure. 2p 3 by 2 to 2s half and 2f half, 2p half to 2s half. And correspondingly their quantum numbers are written, G values are written. Selection rule. As I said, if we would perpendicular to the field, we have P component and S component. We would parallel, we have P component and S component. So, generally S component is delta M is plus and minus 1 and P component is delta M is equal to 0. Delta M means what? This is M value. So, this initial M value and final M value change delta M. Intensity. If transition is from I to J, you can find the intensity with this formula. So intensity, I will not go in the details of intensity rule, but intensity also can be calculated just by knowledge of quantum numbers. Everything is possible in atomic spectroscopy if you know quantum numbers. So quantum number is very important. This is the thing which you can put in your near your God, is it not? Because always we pray God, every day we pray God. If you want to learn atomic spectroscopy, by all means, wholeheartedly put them in nearby your God. So for these two transitions, one, these two, I have these transitions. And of course, for transition having equal J value, they are forbidden. They are not seen. That also, this is pi component, P component, and this is sigma component, S component. I will not discuss how these transitions have come because I will discuss the transitions on the triplet spectra. And these are the selection rule, delta L plus and minus R. These to this, these transitions only are allowed. DTS is not allowed because delta L. And delta M 0, delta M plus and minus 1. So what I have written the energy difference. Here, magnetic quantum numbers, MJ, 3 by 2, 2 minus 3 by 2, half, 2 minus half, half, 2 minus half. And these are the G values. And I want MG value. I can find out intensity in other way. How? I know MG of this and I know MG of final level. Just subtract MG of final and initial level, you will get intensity. And you can just see the trend. Wow. This is the example for the Zeeman pattern for triplet. So, 3P to 3S transition. And we know all S states are single. How? Because triplet, yes, though it is triplet, it has not three components, it has only one component because L is equal to 0. General question is asked, why all S states are single? So we have 3P states and one S state, triplet. So 3P2, 3S, 3P1, 3S1, 3P0, 3S. So these are three lines actually in fine structure. But how many lines you get? 9, 15, 18. 18 line get. We get for 3 lines, you get 18 lines. How? So very simple. Write M for initial state. 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2. Write M for the initial. 1, 0, minus 1. Of course, this has slightly shifted. I'm sorry for this. This should be like this. So these are vertical transitions. 1, 1, 0, 0, 2. These are P components. Delta M 0, 1, 1, 1, 1. These are P components. Vertical. And these are diagonal components. These are S components. So S component has two S components. Pink and green. And yellow are the P components. And take difference mg, because mg you already have. So take mg. So from this you can find the intensity. You see that intensity decreases like this for this intensity. So this is calculated pattern. And observed pattern also is same. But of course P component and S component, they cannot be plotted on the same, cannot be seen in the one. And this is the energy level diagram. You also can develop this energy level diagram. I'm very honest and proud to tell you fact that almost 80% diagram of this presentation I have drawn myself. Unless you draw it out yourself, you will not understand. If you just copy, if you xerox them, you will not understand. Unless you draw them, you will not know the scale and the position and all. So 3P 3S, 3P2, 3S2, 3P1, 3S1, 3P0, 3S1. These are the three lines. And for three lines, by applying the selection rule, delta L is 1 plus and minus 1. So these transitions are allowed. And delta M is equal to 0, this to this, this to this. So by you, I have a separate lecture. I take some three lectures to teach G-Mann effect on blackboard. So of course it is very difficult to explain you how each and every transition goes from up to down in the sort of 2 hours. But yes, it is possible. Do it by draw each and every line by following the selection rule, and intensity can be calculated. And you can find many examples like this in SET and NET examination. In compute G-Mann pattern. When I qualified SET, this was the descriptive type of example examination, and in NET and GATE examination also there is a description. So they usually ask to compute G-Mann patterns. So you can just see at the example and you can compute the G-Mann pattern. If you know the theory perfectly, yes, it is possible. You will surprise, or it is not the thing of surprise for all of you, that I can compute each and every G-Mann pattern, theoretically calculate its intensity, if I just sit for 10 minutes, one example, and every without seeing any reference. What I just need to know is the quantum numbers. Fine. Now if I increase the strength of the applied magnetic field, the coupling between J and B gets broken. Means orbital motion and spin motion, they are coupled to the applied magnetic field. So J is splitting, precessing around applied magnetic field. But if I apply the strength of applied magnetic field, there would be perturbation in the orbital and spin motion of the electron. And orbital and spin motion, they will be independently coupled with the applied magnetic field. And that is the reason why I have shown vector L bar and S bar precessing independently of each other along the magnetic. In that case, the energy levels will be splitted from the fine structure level by this amount. The ML due to interaction of L with B. 2MS, we have two orientation, 1 and 2. Therefore, 2MSL and AMLMS. Still, there is coupling between orbital and spin motion, because still electron is precessing and it is orbiting around the nucleus. It has not left the atom. Still, it is there. So, this component is already there, AMLMS. this component will be there even we apply electric field, which will come in Stark effect later on. So what you need to do for finding the, so in this case, as I said, in the pass and back effect, there will be number of lines will be decreased. Okay. So for 3P2 or 3P1 or 3P0 or triplet, for a given triplet, so I need to write the magnetic quantum numbers. S is equal to 1, L is equal to 1, and MS, despite of a J, MS changes from 1 to minus 1, 1 to minus 1. So I write all possible combinations, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, minus 1. By placing these 3P, 3P1, and 3P0 term values at appropriate sides, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, minus 1. ML I write 1, 0, minus 1, 1, 0, minus 1, 1, 0, minus 1. Now I do the calculation. 2MS there. ML plus 2MS there. AMLMS there. Just from the knowledge. ML plus MS there. And my these combinations are already there. Interaction energy from fine structure I can calculate. M from magnetic Zeeman effect. 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2, 1, 0, minus 1. Now what I see. Mg also I can calculate from G. So this is G money. And this is the calculation for this term. So what I see, my weak field energy level, where 2 is the magnetic quantum number, my strong field magnetic level, where its quantum number is ML plus MS, sum of 2, is 2 and is shifted by A. 1 corresponds to 1, shifted, no shifting. 0 corresponds to 0, minus A shifting. Minus 1 corresponds to 1, 0 shifting. So similarly. So 3 components. I have not shown here transitions, of course, because if I show again transition, it will be a complicated problem. Just analogy for weak to strong, because we cannot directly apply a strong field. We just slowly increase field and then strong weak field becomes strong field. So 2 in Zeeman corresponds to 3 in Paschenbach or strong field, and it's a shifted by 1. So similarly, we can correlate this, and just from this table, you can know the how many lines are decreased and how the lines can be decreased in the spectrum. This is another example of 3D 1, 2, 3. I will not. I have done this exercise. I have done this exercise for all my students in 1999 or maybe when I was MSc student. I can show you my notebook where all these tables they appear. So for this, similarly, I can correlate weak field and strong field energy levels. And these are the energy levels drawn by me in, of course, Microsoft Word. Therefore, screenshot I have taken. Otherwise, I would have shown you colored lines. Fine, this was the business of magnetic field. What happens to the energy levels when we apply electric field? So there is a splitting of the atomic energy levels. And we take an example of a hydrogen, Balmer series. So in 1913, Stark observed, in case of hydrogen, if he apply 1 lakh volt per centimeter, somebody will say how to apply, how to create 1 volt, and how he might have created in 1913. You see, this is the field, this is not the potential. If we apply 1 volt in within 1 micron distance, it will be 1 divided by 10 to the power of minus 6. So 10 to the power of 6 volt per centimeter. So in that perspective, you see. So when you apply that much field, then energy levels get split. And this splitting of the energy levels is due to the electric field requires. The field polarizes the atom. The atom will be polarized. Means positive and negative charges will be. So electron will be independently precess around the electric field vector. And then they interact. Of course, spinning and orbital motion is there. But polarization will be there. And then here also P component and S component is there, depending on how you view the pattern. The electric interaction energy is given by AF plus BF square plus CF cube plus etc, 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 where A, B, C are the field constant and they can be calculated by the simple formula they were derived by classical and quantum concepts. And you can see typical values of A, B, C of your 10 to the power minus 5, 10 to the power minus 16, 10 to the power minus, very small. But though the values of A, B, and C, they are meager, how the splitting occurs? That occurs due to field, because here it is multiplied. Here it is multiplied. When you apply 10 to the power of 6 volt per centimeter field and multiply it to B, 10 to the power of 16, the number comes out. Delta T comes to 10 to the power of minus 10. Is it not? Centimeter. That is enormous. And therefore, ABC are, you can see, if you see the derivation for ABC, it is function of H, pi, M, C. These are natural constant. N. N is our principal quantum number. N1 and N2 are the azimuthal quantum numbers. And they can be defined, the orbital model of a hydrogen in an electric field. N1, you can see, L, when projected on field, it gives ML, very similar to magnetic field. And we have N1 for this motion and N2 for this motion. So we have two angles, one this and other that. So those two, and these values from 0, 2 and minus 1. And based upon values of N1 and N2, and A, B and C can be calculated and can be put, and the interaction energy can be calculated. So here also, J precesses around F and the projection of J on MJ. F is the electric field, keep in mind. So this is a classical vector model for the hydrogen atom in the weak electric field. Oh, I will take an hour to explain how the energy level diagram for the Stark effect occurs. But yes, these are no field levels, only four components, and you can get so many components. And these can be calculated as in case of a G-Mann effect, and can be shown for every quantum numbers for N1 is equal to 2 and 3. This is a weak field Stark effect. And when the strong field Stark effect, the coupling will be broken and S and J will be independently precess upon electric field. And in that case, the interaction energy would be now different. It would be A, B, A, F, etc., etc. in weak field. For strong field, it would be N, N2 minus N1, F, A, M, L, M. Still, there is a coupling between orbital and spin motion. And therefore, this is the magnetic contribution. So this is there. F is there. And it is large. So what you need to know, when you apply high electric field, you need to know strength of the electric field. And you need to know N, in which orbit it is. For Balmer series, for hydrogen, you know N. And you need to know N2 and N1. We know formula for that. And this is the term table. So N is equal to 1, 2 and 3, you can find N2 and N1. So all possible combinations are N2 and N1. N2 minus N1, N1 into N2 minus N1, it is needed there. MLMS, we know, 1, 2 minus 1, minus 2 to minus, oh, plus 2 and plus minus half, and you can find AMLMS and put there. And theoretically, you can determine the amount by which the term value has shifted, and you can show it. This is very complicated. And I'm late by 5 minutes. This was the end of my presentation. All of you may note down my email address and interact with me in this regard. kyr_phy@unishivaji.ac.in.